Hello and welcome back to Plug and Pay, a show where we bring you the latest and greatest of global payroll. I'm Angelique, Paysar's Head of Content, and today I'm here with Max, our Head of Service Delivery. How are you doing today, Max?
Excellent, Angelique. It's another day in Global Payroll, and I actually sent Mark, our CEO, a picture of Pinky in the Brain because today we're going to again conquer the world of Global Payroll. It's great to be back on another podcast with you, Angelique.
It is. And actually, today we are kicking off our new season, season 5. So, of course, it's going to be an extra special episode. For those of you who follow us over on LinkedIn, you probably have seen that we recently did another Paysar on the Go event, and this time in the lovely city of Dublin. So, I wanted to ask you, Max, out of the 4 events we've done so far, personally, maybe I'm biased because I organized it, but I have to say, I really loved our Dublin event. I feel like they're getting better every single time. So tell me, what are your initial feelings about our event we did?
Well, it's hard to argue with the organizer, Angelique. No, I do agree. Although I also loved our 2 Amsterdam events and in Warsaw, they all have a different dynamic. It's a different country, different people set up. But I think I do agree that the overall vibe with the audience and the people who joined was superb. I saw everyone connecting with each other, people who've never met before or people who've only followed each other on LinkedIn, realize that the other person is actually a real human being. And, you know, it kind of goes to the 2 main objectives of our event. One is to kind of evangelize Paysar and Global Payroll, but the other one, maybe most importantly, is to get people connected. Because it's not often that Global Payroll people get out of their busy schedules just to meet other Global Payroll people. And you then don't need to spend the first 30 minutes explaining what you're doing and what payroll actually is. Because you look each other in the eye and you understand, okay, you know what I'm going through. So how do you solve this? How do you solve that? And I truly love people connecting. And, you know, everyone stayed until the end and then the extra end and then the extra, extra end. Then we had speakers, you know, one of our three of our customers, and I did a little Fred story, was perfectly organized by you. The venue was awesome. So yeah, I'm still vibing actually. It was a week ago, I think. No, not a week ago. Was it a week ago?
Yeah, it was. I'm also still vibing. And yeah, definitely seeing everyone come together, whether that's people from Paysar, existing clients, new people we've never met before, people, as you said, that maybe have met virtually but not in person, providers, people working for big companies, small companies. Like, it was just such a mix. And the one thing everyone has in common is that passion. So it was really, as always, it's been really nice to see. Now, you stole a little bit of what I was about to say, but we did have the pleasure of inviting 3 of our Paysar clients to join us and actually share with everyone their transformations since working with Paysar, since implementing the technology. And there are actually 3 very different stories. The first was Celine Caveye from Fagron. She is the Global HR Director. We then had Brona Grogan, who is CEO of Paycheck Plus, and also Rob Faulkner, who is now the Associate Director of Payroll at Regeneron. But at the time of the transformation, he was working at Mercury Engineering. So I wanted to ask you, Max, if you could share a little bit with us, for those who weren't able to make it to the event, some of the key takeaways from each of the talks. Now, I know you outlined this a little bit in our recent blog post, but for those who haven't seen that yet, that's over on the Paysar blog. And here today, I'd love for you to expand a little bit on what were your main takeaways.
Of course. Thanks, Angelique. So the main takeaway is how open our platform is. Because just look at the customers that we had speaking, a provider, Paycheck Plus, you know, a premier bureau in Ireland and UK, Mercury Engineering, an engineering company with a mixed workforce, people working in the data centers or on the sites, office staff. We had Fagron, a pharmaceutical company, with a lot of M&A, a lot of local business dynamics. And all of this is managed through the same SaaS platform called Paysar. No separate instances. The same platform helps these 3 people and their team members and companies overcome their global payroll challenges. For me, still one of the main reasons why I chose over a year ago to join Paysar, because I saw the potential of it. And it's so great to then see people who've actually implemented it, who actually use it, tell their stories openly at an event in Dublin. So that was probably my main key takeaway, but I presume you're also looking for some takeaways for each of the speakers. Let's maybe start with Celine, and it's actually pretty funny because Celine and I know each other for maybe over 10 years because she wanted to hire me as a payroll specialist back then at Fagron. Well, that didn't happen, but we still found a way to work together. So she says, you mentioned a group HR director and I think around 3,000 countries, that would be a lot. New countries from Mars, Venus, everywhere, right? Processes payroll everywhere. No, 3,000 employees, 20 plus countries, highly localized. And she felt the need to do something because the business demanded her to restructure not just payroll, but the overall HR organization. And she then decided to, you know, revamp the business partners, the competency centers, the HR operations and payroll, and look for a shared service structure. So she then finds her, you know, with a situation that's core to our value proposition. You need standardization on one hand, because you want to centralize and scale processes in a shared service center, but you still want to be flexible enough to meet the demands of the local businesses, which were still very locally driven with Fagron. A lot of M&A activity, local market needs. And then she went out and developed a global payroll strategy that was actually based, super proud, on one of my best practices I first shared in 2017 with what was still then called the Global Payroll Management Institute, now Payo. So do become a subscriber and look for the best practice. It's a white paper that speaks about how to approach global payroll management from strategy, governance, operating model, and service delivery. And she actually beautifully applied that to her organization with an overall purpose statement that we know, and we will talk about in future episodes, Angelique, Gen Z is super interested in. So it might be a way to get the Gen Zs into global payroll, but that's a cliffhanger for later. So again, I went to this discovery, did all the groundwork and launched an RFP to look basically at every vendor profile out there, global aggregators, global networks, regional providers, and open platforms like us and one of our main competitors, right? And she ended up choosing us naturally because she was a presenter at our event. And maybe one of the key takeaways of that implementation is that we don't force the pace of that implementation. So I've been at the receiving end, right, as a global payroll manager of those implementations. And typically a provider wants you to implement as quickly as possible, therefore generating revenues and move on to the next project. I think what we did is adapt to the pace of a company like Fagron, which is super important because they don't just implement payroll. They're basically reorganizing the whole HR suite within the company with a lot of moving parts, setting up service centers in Barcelona, actually, and then having the ability to deploy a Payzar platform on top of your existing payroll providers, where you also made some key changes in local payroll providers that we help them find new partners, give them some options, and they contract and decide directly. Then being able to modularly deploy the platform to say, okay, maybe for the US and LATAM, I'm not going to need all the operational workflows, but I still want to get my reporting in place because ESG is mandated for that company per the 1st of Jan of this year. So she does need to get that whole reporting done. And she saw the opportunity to deploy payroll there, which is a very light implementation. Whereas in EMEA, in line with the service center, she wanted to standardize the whole process end-to-end with upstream data flows, outbound data flows, standardized controls, workflows. Compliance was a big thing to make sure there's not a lot of PII data flying around on emails, right? Who does that in 2024? Well, I'll tell you a little dirty secret. A lot of people still do that, Angelique. But you don't need to. And she's still implementing. We're still partnering with her to say, okay, what would you actually do? And I personally am kind of a free consultant to them just based on my experience and with Payzar to help them do that transformation. So that was, I think, the story of Celine, but you were there as well, Angelique. What was your main take?
Yeah, no, I think what you mentioned about flexibility is it keeps coming up in that story as well in general, because of the fact that, you know, you mentioned with Payzar, you can implement at whatever pace you want, as fast as you want. I think that will be said within the other stories that we hear today as well. But that flexibility, I think, goes for so many things. Both, you know, if you do like your providers, that you can keep them. If you don't, we can help you find them. You know, if you want to employ all the modules for every single country, you can. But most likely, you're going to have specific needs for specific ones. And that's also fine. So I think, yeah, I would say the main takeaway is like just seeing that flexibility in all different stages of the transformation. So I think that brings us nicely onto our next one, which was actually a different perspective. It's the provider perspective. And for that, we had Brona Grogan from Paycheck Plus, another client of ours. Paycheck Plus processed 850 million euros of payments in 360,000 payslips in 2023. And that was across 8,500 different customers. So all of that has been processed through their Engage platform. Now, what is Engage? Engage is the way that Paycheck Plus have renamed the Paysar technology and white labeled it for their company. And that's something, by the way, that you providers out there can do. So I wanted to ask you, Max, what were your thoughts on hearing Paycheck Plus's journey of such a considerable amount of clients and actually in a pretty fast amount of time? So yes, tell me a little bit about your thoughts on Paycheck Plus.
Well, first of all, it was great to see Brona again, because I first met her in Dublin in 2017 when she was actually attending a course I was teaching on managing global across the globe. So that was the first time I met her and Riley, who was previously the CEO and handed over to Brona. So it was great to connect with her again. I'm just blown away by how they've grown as a company. Right. And
that also she shared of the whiteboard. Yeah,
for those who didn't join, which probably will be most of the people listening to the podcast, she showed a picture of the team in the early days of the company with a whiteboard. I still have I still have a whiteboard. I love a whiteboard, right? Because you can wipe what you've done. It's much better than to tick something on the screen. Anyways, call me old school. So she was managing with her team the customers on a whiteboard, just listing all the customers, seeing the deadlines and the stages, and just adding tick marks to it to see whether progress was made, which is great, right? But you can't manage the numbers and the volumes that you've shared, Angelique, in that type of setting, right? So taking a leap forward, they now still operate, I think, three different payroll engines, two in Ireland, one in the UK. And that inherently has the complexity of not being customer facing. So those payroll engines are great to process payroll in line with local rules and regulations, but you can't get a customer to log in and see where their payroll's at. You can't get them to log in to fetch their reports. The team members, they can't go in there to manage their work. So they saw the gap, and they actually met Trevor Townsend, one of our co-founders, a COO, and they engaged through very early in the Paysar journey. And since then, they've deployed almost all of our modules. And I think the critical piece is what they've done is they said to all their customers, this is how we will now interact with you. And this is what would be the benefits for you. This would be the benefits for us. And she also shared, it wasn't always an easy conversation, right? There are still some customers who said, well, you know, why should I change? What's in it for me? But then it becomes an outlier. So if you don't adopt, then maybe that becomes an outlier of a service at an additional charge. So I think the way they manage their rollout in, I think, 8 months across all those customers in different batches and waves was super, super inspiring. And for the platform itself, right? Again, I keep coming back to it's the same instance. Angelique, when I give demos to customers, payroll friends or leads, I log into Paysar. And I can give a demo to a provider to show their end and the customer, and I can show a demo to the customer. It's the same functionality, and getting feedback from both sides of the industry makes the platform so strong. But it's only a platform, right? I have an iPhone. My mother has an iPhone. I love you, Mom, but you use like 0.1% of the iPhone. I maybe use 10% of the iPhone. It's the same piece of technology. So it's still down to the user how to adopt it. And I think they've done that in a brilliant way. And maybe another metric is that they've doubled their revenues while proportionally reduced their resources by 30%.
Yeah.
That shows how efficient it is to work with the platform, to manage your own operations, and interact with the customers. Moving away from a whiteboard in the digital age, staying ahead of other payrolls, I think it was an amazing story.
Yes, agreed. And I think, as you said, there's something really nice and satisfying about wiping away the whiteboard. Yeah. But at the end of the day, it's not scalable. And this transformation really showed the lengths that you can scale and also the timeline as well of how fast it can happen. Yeah, I was really happy and also inspired to hear that story from Paycheck yeah. Plus. So let's move on now to the final case study. And that was from Rob Faulkner. His company at the time, Mercury Engineering, had over 3,000 employees across 14 different countries. And now this transformation was specifically about moving from a global aggregator model to using Payzar's technology and local providers. So probably the start of this story is going to be, what was that situation they were in, those challenges they were facing with the global aggregator model? And I know that you've obviously had your experience as well. So
yes.
Yeah, tell me a little bit about those challenges, what they look like.
Yeah, it's a prime example of how it works with aggregators, right? With all due respect, it does work in some situations and I'm happy for them, but in this specific context and Rob was in, it just didn't fit. And Rob was brave and skilled enough to convince his senior stakeholders that the change needed to be made. And he supported that business case with the facts from this his situation. He had very early cutoffs. Now, anyone working in payroll, you know, you're not in favor of an early cutoff. Because what does it mean? You're going to your stakeholders, they need to get the data in early, who then in return need to get to the employees to get the data in early. So it burdens the whole upstream process. And in the end, it also burdens payroll because naturally there will be changes after cutoff. Therefore, there are off cycles, there are reruns. It just impacts the overall payroll process. He also had a lot of employee questions due to a simple situation of the payslips not being released or not being released on time, which especially with his workforce who, you know, some of them live paycheck by paycheck, right? So you need to get that visibility and standardized way of getting payslips in, especially on a mobile workforce that doesn't even own a laptop. He also had a very costly setup, which wasn't a driving factor, but if you report into finance or need to get an approval of a CEO, they always like to see cost savings. The other thing is just very practical, which I always work with my team. You want access to direct local experts, right?
Yes.
If you're managing 14 countries, you can't be a payroll SME for all of those countries. You would know the basics, probably very skilled in one or two countries, like in his case, Ireland, maybe UK, but he was also processing payroll in Poland. Well, his Polish is just as bad as mine. I do know a few words, but I can't speak payroll in Polish. So he needs access to local experts. And his model was through a middleman sitting somewhere in a faraway country who also didn't really know the local language or the local payroll legislation. So it was a very big delay when his team was pressured by stakeholders or employees to come up with answers. It took him 5 to 6 days sometimes. And his payroll process cycles from submitting to approving, it's like 7 to 10 days, which is ridiculous. You can't have a process like that. So Rob said, enough is enough. He's going to stop. Now, then, of course, he moved to us because he already used us at his prior company, Lionbridge. He knew he needed us, and he went through all the due diligence and then ended up using the platform again. And I could talk all day about Mercury Engineering, but go on the website, find the case study, because I just want to highlight one question that was actually asked by one of my other good friends, Bernie O'Connor, who I also met in 2017 the first time, just like Brona, who attended my course Managing Global Payroll Across the Globe. It's a small world after all. She asked to Rob, which is a question I get a lot, and I actually also asked Mark, I think in 2018 when I first met him. So how does it work if you move from one central contract as an aggregator to local payroll providers? How do you do that? How do you manage that change? How do you manage legal? How do you manage procurement? And Rob had a nice little smile on his face saying, well, I got these questions too. So he was really honest and upfront about it. He said, yeah, there was some work to be done, right? So if you go to legal or procurement and you say there's extra work, because naturally you would need to go to some more local contracts. But he said, I also explained the business case to them. This is what it saves the company. This is how it supports the business. And let's face it, you sign the contract once, just like you sign your employment contract. I think, Angelique, you don't sit down with Sam every month to review your contract, right? You review your performance, you review the way of working. So a contract is really a one-time thing. So he then convinced procurement and legal, and they got this done in a couple of months. So yes, it was a little bit of additional effort, but the benefits outweighed so much. And that was really eye-opening for a lot of attendees, because the open model sounds great, and it is great, but there's always this fear of the unknown. Okay, now I need to go to local providers. But that's solvable because the benefits outweigh that little bit of effort.
Yeah, I agree. And actually, I remember exactly the point you were mentioning. I think the words Rob used that really stuck with me was the short-term pain was worth the long-term gain, because the previous situation was just pain. Because obviously it might take some initial time to set up and stuff, but at the end of the day, you were already struggling with so many different things beforehand, then, you know, it's worth it in the long term. So that did also really stay with me. That was also my takeaway from Rob. So I think that now brings us on to the final talk, and that was by none other than yourself. Of course, our famous friend Fred is back again for chapter 4. So without further ado, let's hear Fred's story.
Professional compliance. So what we try to do with Payzar is invent a person that takes a little piece of your personality and experience into one character. That character is called Fred. Now, you've missed the first three chapters. No worries, it's available on YouTube. Of course, after today, you'll go binge watching our channel on YouTube, like and subscribe. Thanks for that, and thanks on behalf of Angelique. But just in case you missed it and you had something else to do, like managing payrolls, let me recap what happened in chapter 1, 2, and 3, because you're in a very fortunate position. You're alive at chapter 4 of Fred. So chapter 1 was actually in Amsterdam, October last year. Fred is a global payroll manager, actually born in Dublin. We all have our problems, it's fine. He has 3 kids and a lovely wife, but he moved over to the Netherlands. Obviously, weather wasn't a condition, because we more or less have the same climate. So he is a global payroll manager for a large manufacturing site, with the largest one actually being in Germany, 20,000 employees, 35 countries, about 8 staff members throughout the world. His manager sits in APEC. God knows why, but he sits in APEC. And in chapter 1, actually, probably Fred is the one who told you, Celine, because he was trying to break through some sticky paradigms, like there's only one size fits all, there's only one global vendor. The global countries telling them, I am too difficult to standardize. Who's ever been told by a local country that they're special and different and not able to standardize? Okay, you're lying, because that happens. Yeah. I won't give you like a mic if you put up your hands. All right, so he broke through, which was all awesome. He was trying to build his case for change and all of that, and he submitted kind of a business case. But then chapter 2 happened. I think, Rob, you've mentioned something around downloading a payslip, password protecting it, right? So Mary is the general manager of the main manufacturing site in Germany. And have you heard of the concept in payroll that everyone is equal, but some are more equal? Right. Some are just more equal, or at least feel they're more equal. Are you also using internal chat tools like Microsoft Teams or something like that? Zoom. We use Zoom anymore, right? I don't want to left Zoom. So, and do you know a person who does this? Like every sentence. That's Trevor for us at Slack. Just every word. That's Mary too. So Mary needs her payslip. Mary needs her payslip. She's a general manager. She's different than anyone else. Of course, Fred, just like you, kids are in bed, the laptop goes up because global payroll never sleeps. It's all the time zones, right? You just want to finish your emails. There's Mary. Mary needs her payslip. Okay. So he goes into the employee portal, 404 error.
So can't access it anyway, big mess. He has a great provider in Germany called Peter. So he calls Peter, Peter just sent me the paycheck, great. So he continues working and he notices my email, like I don't get the email from my beloved Peter. So he calls up Peter again. He says, like, Peter, where's the email? Yeah, yeah, I sent it, let me check out. And he says, I sent it to the wrong thread. So now the payslip of Mary is with a different Fred and a different customer. So now Fred needs to, the real Fred, the one and only green Fred, needs to log an issue. And of course Mary is not being like a supportive, oh, it can happen, it's all fine. Mary sends a message to the CEO, the CFO, the CHRO, like Fred messed up, Fred's payslip, Fred thinks Peter, verdammt nochmal. But okay, you know, Peter was a great guy. So now he's under audit. Which brings us to chapter 3, which was actually in beautiful Warsaw, Marta. We're still sad that you weren't there, but you're here, and that's what matters, Marta. So we were in Warsaw, and he was building up to, who's been in internal audits? Yeah? No, really? Nobody? You never had an internal audit?
Oh, yeah.
Jeez, like you're a super special payroll people. You never had an audit. You should all come on stage, share your best practices. Liars. but for the rest, I love you. I love that you're here. So Fred was also under internal audits. Everyone did a walkthrough with a new associate in internal audit who doesn't know how to read their own paycheck, like walkthrough slides. He goes through the painful process. It takes a lot of time. Then he gets a PDC provided by customer, a list, a whole Excel spreadsheet. He just went through a database and now they send the auditor, send the spreadsheet over email to deliver. Anyway, he accepted it, so he gets this list. He needs to deliver it in 3 days. Yeah, so they wait, and they send you for 3 days. So he's a little bit late, but then he delivers. And then he gets an audit report. Of course, he needs to deliver it with 3 days, but Fred needs to wait 3 months for the audit report. A few iterations, he gets the report, and it's in his face, it's there. Fred, the great progressive global payroll manager, gets an audit report where it says, basically, you can't do your work. Like red flags everywhere. So Fred starts crying. What do? You go to your spouse, right, who's on Netflix, and what's wrong, Fred? Okay. So, but then she says, like an epiphany moment for Fred, what if you turn an internal audit report into an opportunity? And then Fred has his light bulb moment, yes, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to build my business case. I'm going to submit it again. I'm going to socialize it with great friends. Sorry, Celine from HR, we love you. You're always on time, quality data, never miss a deadline. HR is fantastic. He doesn't see me. Look at Fred now. Fred is waiting. And waiting. And just like anyone with an exam, you're like refreshing your inbox, right? He refreshes until it looks like this. So he doesn't know if his business case is approved. And that's where we find Fred. So Fred is still refreshing. Nobody's on their phone right now because Fred's on his phone and he's refreshing, refreshing.
Aww.
Yeah, right? He did all the work, waiting for 3 months. Now it's rejected. But he gets another email to please come into the office tomorrow. Normally he works remote. Come into the office at 8 a.m. He has 3 kids that need to go to school, right? 8 a.m. being in the office is a mess. It's a challenge. So again, he looks at his wife. Okay, that's domestic little story I'll maybe do over a pint of Guinness. I don't know, right? Because I'm not Fred. We're all Fred, so you might relate. But he needs to go into the office. Can you imagine you just get your business case rejected? The next day you know that your manager from Singapore flew over to come into your office in Amsterdam and you need to be there at 8 a.m. Like he sleeps like a baby. No, he doesn't sleep. Right? He goes downstairs, doesn't sleep, but decides just to go into the office a little bit early. And that's his manager. He sits there. Not only is Fred's business case rejected, he's being laid off.
Poor old Fred.
Yeah. Who's ever been laid off before? No one? Oh, you. Just me. Okay. Yeah, it's sad, right? Yeah. But life goes on. I'm here, Dublin. Look at me. Right? But Fred's not there yet. Then Fred is super, super sad because he was breaking through his paradigms. He was accepting the audits, building a business case, but now he's.
Does anybody want to take it anymore? Jump, let's go on. Inside my heart is
So Fred, just like me, picks himself up. He finds himself again with renewed energy. But you need to work through a transition period. It's freaking difficult to be laid off and then need to work 6 months to deliver your payroll to the new company that's being divested. And when he does it, he also supports his team of 8 people who are in the same boat, also need to find new jobs. But then he goes on LinkedIn, right? Who's a LinkedIn person? He's a global payroll manager for about 10 years. Like, am I done with these time zones? Maybe after like hearing Brona's story, I want to be a provider, right? Moving from whiteboards to platforms. Maybe I want to be raw, or maybe I don't want to be raw. She doesn't want to be raw. So Fred, here's to the grapevine, actually, that Barcelona, Celine, might be a great place. I'm going to rehearse this. It's excellent. So Barcelona, he goes and decides to work in Barcelona as an EMEA payroll manager. EMEA, not global anymore, because he's done with Singapore and Silicon Valley. The time zones are killing him. So he's doing EMEA, smaller scope, a tech company, 5,000 employees in about 20 countries, rapidly promoting new countries and getting into that. So he goes to Barcelona. He goes to his first day, he looks so sharp, right? His suit and tie, he can't get enough of his green shirt. And tech guy's over there, this is great, he works hybrid, 3 days a week from home, 2 days in the office, right? It's amazing, he loves it. Then he gets acronyms at GTKY. Do you guys get GTKY? Get to know you? And ICMY, you know ICMY? Vacationisting, TTYF. He's like coming from an old manufacturing company, going to this tech company with all of these acronyms. It's like, what the hell? GTKY, no, I don't want to get to know you. I don't want to pay you. But then, look at Fred, right? He can work from home. This is the Zoom outfit, remember? I all did it. Don't lie, you all did it. I still do it. So he sits there with his wife, everyone's happy. Apparently his wife is fond of limoncello. Can't have any other drink that's green. And you drink out of a wine glass, by the way, it should be a shot glass. Anyway. So he goes into GTKY, and then he's super enthusiastic. He has, of course, no handover from the prior payroll manager, because he was already long gone when he came. Right? So he asks his payroll team, can you give me your processes? They say, what? What type of controls do you execute? Yeah, I run a report here and there, right? Okay, well, we need to change. No, we don't know why. We're paying people a long time, right? So Fred finds himself not having the luxury, like other people, to onboard and say, well, I want to settle in for a couple of days because the first cycle is on the way, right? If you start a payroll job on the first of the month, you need to pay people at least on the 25th, or in your case, at Mercury, next Thursday. And you better approve the payroll, right? Because otherwise you're not paying people. So the pressure, I don't envy you. I've been you, it's like a job nobody understands until you're in it, right? You can explain as much as you like to your spouses, they will never get it. So he's very close to it. His 2 days in, he still needs to finalize the payroll. He has loads of spreadsheet, manual work, not just a lot of spreadsheet, but fee lookup, age lookup, awesome. No traceability, no auditability, no consistency, but okay. Fred recognizes he needs to actually start approving the payroll. And he does. 20 countries, 5,000 employees. Fred approves the payroll. Yes. So Fred, Freddie Mercury, he thinks that we are... He's super happy. He logs in. No funding, payments rejected. Who's ever been in a situation that were, we won't tell your company names, right, but no funding, I also, and we need to set up a process, you need to forecast, because of course, what the team of Fred didn't say is this was an exceptional month with exceptionally high bonuses and commissions that the treasury didn't know. So they just had a normal forecast, he found out, he still recovered. But of course, now Fred is like this, this is also part of the tech, right, they have a yoga room. I actually had a yoga room once. He had a yoga room too. So he sits down and he thinks, what do I need to do? I need to change. I can't have this life anymore. I just was laid off. Had to stay off for 6 months. bring my family to Barcelona. It's an amazing life right in Barcelona, great, a lot of public holidays. I haven't mentioned they have a lot of public holidays. So he gets on a plane to Dublin because he hears about a great event from Pazar. He does have a good shirt now, and he goes and flies Ryanair. Great experience, great airline, if you're smelling.
That's extra-trainings multiplier, great company.
Great company, yeah, all right, mixed opinions. So he comes here to get some insights and talk to you. Hey, Fred. Can you come? He's still... No, he's not there. Okay, anyway, so he comes here, and now we go into the actual content. So flexibility and standardization, that's what Celine talked about, that's what Ron talked about, actually what Brona also talked about. We surveyed a lot of payroll folks and asked them a very easy question. What do you find more important? Standardization or flexibility or both? 60% indicated they want both flexibility and standardization. Why? Who works in an EMEA slash global role? So they all ask you need to be standardized. And then the employees ask you, you need to be flexible. But how are you gonna combine flexibility and standardization? Where you need to talk to Rob, Celine, and Marta. You'll have a great night. It's on us, okay? So we ask people, what do you actually look for a payroll provider strategy if you have a multi-country payroll? Multi-country is like a 10 plus countries, right? Where it used to be like, oh, there's one provider. I also thought there's one provider, but maybe not. So they all choose a hybrid, just like hybrid work, a mix of the above. Because I worked at Shell. Shell at the time now, so there are 85,000, 90,000 employees. We had in-house payrolls for larger ones, like 20,000 employees. You don't know how to source with in-house payroll. You had a few in-between payrolls where we used managed service. You had some other payrolls where we said, well, we're going to do a regional here and a regional there, because there's no one size fits all. So finally, and I'm super happy, after June 2010, people agree it will always be a mix of vendors. Therefore, Brona, you can play a role in any global payroll, as you probably are already familiar with. So I think it's a great recognition. And then if you look for priorities of choosing a provider, what you will tell me afterwards is, you need service, but you also need some sort of tech platform, right? Which is not a local payroll engine, but something you could work with. Surprisingly, cost, but that was probably to your point, Rob, is like secondary because, you know, of course cost cutting is great, but not paying people is worse, right? So that's typically what people will be happy to pay for. However, the contact person, I always say the contact person doesn't make you choose a provider, but it makes you stay with a provider. Because how important is a contact person, right? If something happens, you need to be able to get, not like Peter, right? Peter is verdammt nochmal, because Peter sent the patient to the wrong Fred. But there's also a lot of great payroll providers out there. So, well, it doesn't make you choose a provider, it makes you stay. Now, who uses Workday? Good luck. It's HR's dream and payroll's nightmare. That's always my shortest summary of Workday. Sorry, any Workday representatives? Workday's awesome! Yeah. You need a lot of leave days after implementing Workday. All right, so although you have Workday, SuccessFactors, all of these great HCMs, we also, how many data sources do you actually have per payroll? 65% said five or more. So although we focus a lot of integrations, you still need to deal with all of those different data sources to be able to scalable or go to a shared service center. And although I said 65% has five or more, 43% has seven or more. So when you're looking at your own provider strategies or how to improve, think about all those data sources, not just your HRIS or STARS or EVOS, right? You need to look at it holistically. Then, okay. I trust in your honesty. Who allows changes after cutoff? Who does it only by strict exception? Maybe that's probably a better, right? Yeah. I used to be this too, like an escalation level. Yeah. But the strict exception sometimes becomes like more frequent than you would think. But I think, although we might be strict, we're still there to deliver an employee, right? What if you are an employee who comes to a new company, you're being promised an onboarding bonus. This employee doesn't know about the payroll cutoff, eh? Right? They're not choosing, oh, I chose this company because Rob push the payroll cutoff 17 days later. They had no idea. So you would still want to process it. So while I'm a big advocate of standardization, again, you need some level of flexibility, right? Because there could just be a position where you need to do it. Because an employee is still someone you serve. So then we also ask, what is the root cause of payroll errors? A lot of people allow exceptions after cutoff, but 51% said the main root cause of errors is poor quality data input. And 30% says manual processing of those inputs. So in a lot of data sources, root cause is processing of the data, manual data. Now, Fred goes back, totally inspired. Look how sharp Fred looks. I could never look like Fred. This guy is, and this is not Ryanair, because this looks like freaking business class. He got an upgrade, because he now works for a tech company with a yoga. So he goes back totally inspired. He has the industry report in his hands. He is freshly energized, and he goes back. And what is he going to do, you think? He's going to tango with his wife. But before I ask you to tango with each other, I'm going to ask Mr. Trevois to come on the stage, because I'm done. Normally I get up.
So another chapter of Fred's story. And I have to say, I love that ending. Hats off to Mika, our designer as well, for putting Fred all suited and booted in a tango outfit. And I have to say, I think this for me, out of Fred's story so far, was, you know, quite inspirational. And I think it actually really touched some people. So, you know, obviously he was laid off, and speaking to people in the audience, me myself have experience with that. And yeah, I think it really, really connected with people and continued the fact that Fred is this relatable person that we can all find ourselves in, and every payroll professional can. So I think there was also a few key takeaways I wanted to actually talk about.
Great.
Noticed throughout. So one of the key things is the fact that as Fred was looking to make his transformation, he realized you need a mix of providers and service levels, because as we've said before, there is no one size fits all. The only one size fits all is hybrid. And he's looking for that perfect combination that will work, you know, for him, technology platforms as well. And one of the most important things, of course, is the technology. But one thing that's also important and perhaps not spoken about as much is who is your contact person? Who are you working with on a daily basis with your providers? And I think you mentioned, Max, that perhaps a contact person doesn't make you choose a provider, but it can make you stay.
Correct.
And I think also from some of the conversations we had with existing clients, with, you know, all different people at the event, I think that was clear. Like some of the really strong relationships, even some of our Paysar team who were there and meeting for the first time, you know, clients they've worked with and supported, that was something really nice to see as well. And it just goes to show the people you work with are also equally as important in many ways. And I then think that Fred had quite a few realizations in terms of benchmarking himself against his peers. So you shared with us some of the results of the industry reports and the polls that you've been doing. And yes, Fred had the realization, so I'm not the only one who has to process 5 or more different data sources. No, Fred, it's not only you. Majority of people are also in that same boat. And what else did he realize? Well, 60% of his peers are also in an agreement, like Celine, like the examples we've shared today, that flexibility is equally as important as standardization as well. In the part about the post-cutoff changes, I think he had the realization that perhaps he is a little bit too accommodating, which perhaps some payroll professionals can be guilty of, because they are accommodating, but it can be one of the biggest root causes of errors, as we've seen from the results from other global payroll managers answering the polls. So he decided he needs to focus on solving these problems right from the start of the process, from pre-payroll, run payroll to post-payroll. And what did he do to try and make some of these improvements? Well, he found his way over to Dublin to an event to come and listen to some speeches from Celine, Brona, and Rob. And that, I think, has given him some inspiration to take the next step in his career, which, well, we'll have to wait for chapter 5 to see exactly what that is. But the last we know is, yes, he's heading back to Barcelona, and he's in his tango mood.
tangoing indeed. But I think what I try, thanks for the recap, Angelique. What I try to do with Fred virtually coming over to the event is that basically everyone who was there was a kind of Fred who also get out there and speak. So it's very relatable. Yeah,
definitely. And I think also Fred's story, other than the literal tango dancing, really summarized the theme of the event, which was it takes two to tango. And I think we really saw that happen. So it takes two to tango being the provider side and the customer side. And what does that also mean? Well, bringing people together. And I think that was exactly what we did with the event, both with Fred's story, touching people, with the transformation stories, inspiring people and informing them. And overall, just bringing payroll professionals together from both sides and focusing on everything we have in common. Do you have any final key takeaway? That would be mine, but do you have anything?
Chapter 5?
Yes.
Are we able to reveal the location already or not?
We can't reveal location, but more details will be coming soon.
Okay. So we're going to London, right?
Yes, to my hometown.
Exactly.
He's us coming home. Yes, I'm very excited. I'm very excited that Fred's story, Chapter 5, is already underway, but we will be sharing more in the coming weeks. So keep an eye out both on our YouTube channel for all the rest of the speeches that we had. Keep an eye out on our LinkedIn because you'll be getting the details for the future event and how to sign up for that. And as always, if you have any comments for the podcast, if you want to come on and join us, if you have suggestions, just drop us a message at Payza on LinkedIn. And as usual, we'll be uploading new episodes of Plug and Pay every 2 weeks over on our YouTube channel. So that's all from us. Thank you very much for listening.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Hey! Daar bovenop die berg, daar bovenop die berg, daar staat een hek, daar staat een hek, daar staat op je Laura is gek, je Laura is gek en van je. Hey!